Republican House Speaker John Boehner today gave his big speech on the economy at the Economic Club of Washington, D.C., perhaps in part so he could do some name-dropping about where he was.
This building's named in memory of former President Ronald Reagan.
Drink! First page of the speech, name check for Ronald Reagan. At the Republican candidates' debate last week, conveniently held at the Reagan Library, candidate Newt Gingrich, who incidentally as a congressman threw Reagan under the bus during the Iran-Contra scandal, Newt Gingrich took the occasion of the Reagan Library debate to invoke Ronald Reagan by name, not once, not twice, not three times, not four times, not five times, not six times. It actually just hit it.
I served during the Reagan campaign under Ronald Reagan, Reagan Jobs Program, the Reagan Unemployment, the Reagan Library, the Ronald Reagan Technique, President Reagan. President Reagan, I'm with President Reagan.
But it's not just Mr. Gingrich. This is just what it's like to run for any Republican office now. You have to light a Reagan candle and incant Reagan, Reagan, Reagan. You have to give speeches in buildings named Reagan. You have to propose a policy named Reagan. You should consider a pet or a child named Reagan, maybe? What's it like to see the Republican Party's decision to elevate Ronald Reagan as if he is a saint when you are the former president who sat on the inaugural stage with Reagan in 1980 and wrote this about him in your diary that day? On the day President Reagan was inaugurated, President Carter wrote this, quote, "I consider him to be an affable and decent man. His life seems to be governed by a few anecdotes and vignettes that he has memorized. He doesn't seem to like to listen. Excuse me. He doesn't seem to listen when anybody talks to him." Here's former President Jimmy Carter today on the Republican candidates, the religious right, President Obama's reelection chances, and the elevation of Republican sainthood of Ronald Reagan. Among the Republican candidates this year is someone who volunteered for your presidential campaign, Michelle Bachmann.
I know, and I appreciate that she helped me out.
She's, I would love to overhear you two getting the chance to talk now, given how her politics have evolved. But I was thinking about that in reading in the paperback edition of the diary that's just out, you're talking about teaching Sunday school while you were serving as president, and your Christian faith was one of the main things that America knew about you when they were introduced to you as the governor of Georgia and you were running. And now the profession of faith in politics is something that Democrats sometimes try to do, but it has essentially become almost a Republican marker with this rise of the religious right. How did the evangelical Christian world from which you come from turn into the religious right?
They turned against me when I was in office.
Yeah.
You know, and the so-called moral majority and so forth, that was their birth, was in 1976. I didn't even know about them at the time. They were minuscule, had a minuscule effect on my campaign. But they got increasingly strong. And when I was going out of office, as a result of the 1980 election against Reagan, the Southern Baptist Convention and other very conservative evangelists, and I'm considering myself evangelical too, they decided to go with the Republican Party. So they formed an alliance that's unbroken since then with the extremely conservative elements in the Republican Party and extremely conservative elements in the Christian evangelical community. And I don't think that's a good thing for our country. I separated very totally any relationship between government and religion. Just for instance, Billy Graham had been a normal visitor to the White House before I was in office, for Lyndon Johnson and for Richard Nixon and for others. He would hold religious services in the White House. I never did invite him to do so. And the times when I did teach Sunday school in a local Baptist church, it was a completely secret thing in advance. Nobody knew it in advance. So I separated my religious beliefs totally from any aspects of statehood or governance.
Do you think that, do you think it is troubling now to see people running for president doing so by essentially preaching sermons, by talking about their faith as if that is a qualification
for
office?
I think in a slight way it's even unconstitutional for an incumbent president to claim that his own faith should prevail and that other faiths are not warranting equal treatment under the laws or under the president's policies. I think that's it may not be a legal violation of the Constitution, but I think it violates the First Amendment separation. And I think the other thing is that we have seen what I consider to be an unwarranted intrusion of the religious community into the political campaigns. So I think both the president's using his power to promote Christianity and Christians to use their power to try to get that particular chosen person to be in the White House, both violate the principles that I tried to observe when I was in the White House.
Do you think that one of the leading contenders for the Republican nomination is Mitt Romney, who is a Mormon? He would be the first Mormon nominee for president.
Yes.
Do you think that we have progressed far enough as a country in terms of recognizing religion as no barrier to public office, that he could be nominated, he could win as a Mormon?
I hope so. I hope he'll win. I don't hope, I'm not taking a position, but I would be very pleased to see him win the Republican nomination. I don't think anybody's going to beat Obama next year. But my preference, obviously, would be for his religious faith not to be an adverse factor in the choices made about who should be representing the Republican Party.
In terms of the election that you ran against Ronald Reagan in 1980, looking back at that election, it's not lost to history, but it is good to be reminded what a huge deal he made of the Panama Canal Treaty.
I know.
In the way, obviously, that was a major foreign policy issue at the time. Yeah. It's a major foreign policy achievement of yours. He demagogued that as if Panama was the 51st state and you were trying to give it away because you were a godless communist or something. He really did demagogue it.
And that wasn't the only thing. He demagogued also my normalizing diplomatic relations with China.
Yes.
He still felt that Taiwan should be the China when he was running for campaign. And he also demagogued my Mideast peace agreement. He maintained that I gave away Israel's Sinai Desert back to Egypt and so forth. So to a major degree, much more than my predecessors or successors, I lost the support of the Jewish community to my grief. So the things that I did that I think in retrospect were achievements were looked upon then as both controversial and had a negative political impact.
Do you have any feelings one way or the other about the way that President Reagan has been really elevated by the modern Republican Party as their greatest president since Lincoln, as one of the pantheon, as a man who should be on Rushmore? They really celebrate his legacy in a way that they do like no other Republican other than Lincoln, I believe.
Although I don't agree with their assessment of his administration, I certainly don't begrudge their right to choose whomever they choose as an icon for reverence.
Mm-hmm. That's diplomatic and beautifully put.